Let me invite you, if you have a copy of God's Word this morning, to turn or to scroll over to the book of Jeremiah, chapter number 15. Jeremiah chapter 15. And it is good to be back together. It's good to see each other, many of us, for the first time in this calendar year 2020, on this first day of classes. I have looked forward to the beginning of my first full calendar year as your president, and have looked forward to the beginning of the spring semester. I know that for some of you, you're thinking, you know, spring really hasn't sprung yet. I can assure you, where I used to live, it's in the 20s. So this is a glorious providence of the Lord to be in this kind of weather. You know, I often say we are living in very interesting times, and that may be an understatement. We're living in very interesting times, not only here at Southwestern Seminary, just where we find ourselves now, but we're living in very interesting times in the broader culture, particularly in our Southern Baptist Convention of Churches. And, you know, we are not an independent seminary. We are an entity, an institution of the Southern Baptist Convention. We do not stand in isolation from other entities, other seminaries, but of course there is a distinct role and mission and vision that I believe God has always given to Southwestern Seminary since March 14th, 1908. And part of that has been to speak into the life of issues and to speak with the kind of what I pray is convictional words, but also words that are constructive in terms of where we find ourselves. I don't know about you, but a lot of what I see happening around us grieves me, and particularly what I see happening in a lot of cases on social media and the like. These are very troubling times, and particularly for those of you who are new to Southwestern Seminary, we in the fall will recognize officially all who have joined us with a formal pronouncement of you as new Southwesterners. But for those of you who are beginning your studies here at Southwestern Seminary in Scarborough College, you could not have picked a better place to be, in my opinion. But you also have picked a very interesting time in kind of God's economy to be engaging in Christian ministry and mission. When I sat in these, well, it wasn't these chairs because this building wasn't built, but in Truett, when I was a student here, I often thought that the greatest challenges and battles and obstacles that I would have to face would be from out there. But I've had to learn that's just not always the case. The word of the Lord through the prophet Jeremiah, Jeremiah 15, beginning in verse 15. Let me invite you, if you would, to stand with me, that we might honor the reading of the word of God together this morning. And let me just encourage you to follow along in your hearts as I share this word from God's word. The Bible says, "You know, Lord, remember me and take note of me. Avenge me against my persecutors. In your patience, don't take me away. Know that I suffered disgrace for your honor. Your words were found and I ate them. Your words became a delight to me and the joy of my heart. For I bear your name, Lord God of armies. I never sat with the band of revelers and I did not celebrate with them. Because your hand was on me, I sat alone. For you filled me with indignation. Why has my pain become unending, my wound incurable, refusing to be healed? You truly have become like a mirage to me, water that is not reliable. Therefore, this is what the Lord says. If you return, I will take you back. You will stand in my presence. And if you speak noble words rather than worthless ones, you will be my spokesman. It is they who must return to you. You must not return to them. Then I will make you a fortified wall of bronze to this people. They will fight against you, but will not overcome you. For I am with you to save you and rescue you. This is the Lord's declaration. I will rescue you from the power of evil people and redeem you from the grasp of the ruthless." This is the word of our Lord. And thanks be to God this morning. Please be seated and may God richly bless the reading and study of his word together this morning. If you know anything about the prophet Jeremiah, you know, of course, that he was a very unique man of God, given a very unique assignment. He was called by God. God had destined him for a prophetic ministry. But I'm not sure that it's the kind of prophetic ministry, Dr. Allen, that most of us would choose in the preaching ministry, because you go back to places like Jeremiah 7, and God says to Jeremiah, when you speak all these prophetic utterances to them, they will not listen to you. When you call to them, they will not answer you. Now, could you imagine the kind of encouragement you get in a preaching class here? Hey, you need to go out and preach the word in the church, but nobody's going to listen to you. They're not going to like it, right? We don't set out intentionally to say things, hopefully, that we think people are not going to want to hear, especially those who name the name of Christ. And as I mentioned, it can be very easy for us, if we are early in our ministerial trajectory, to think that the greatest challenges we're going to face are going to be from fighting all the devil's crowd out there. And heaven knows there is all kind of compromise and capitulation and, frankly, just crazy out there in terms of what we're having to navigate in the broader culture today. It is not the Bible Belt anymore. It is not a culture that is going to be affirming and encouraging to you in general in terms of following a vocational ministry trajectory. But sometimes I think we fail to remember that the greatest challenge we often face is not from fighting the devil's crowd out there, but from fighting a work of the devil amongst and within those who name the name of Christ. In the church, in our convention of churches. You know, you live long enough and you're going to get fan mail. And maybe it's just because of the position that I now hold, but I got a little piece of fan mail recently. In fact, it's dated on the date of my wife's birthday, January 14th. And it's a 5-page letter. I won't read all of it, but let me just share with you some encouraging words. Your actions have the appearance of a medieval despot that, as was the practice, conquered a kingdom and killed all the previous despot staff for fear they would cause him problems. It is that portrayed by the current dictator of North Korea, who has systematically killed staff and even family members because he was terrified of them. What are you afraid of? And then it ends, in my opinion, the best days of Swibbits are in its past and its future is destined for decline. The premier evangelical seminary in the world will soon become another small cloister of students and faculty echoing in empty halls. Now, if this were written by the president of the Fort Worth Atheist Club or the Tarrant County Freethinkers or the Texas Society for Everything That Is Anti- God, I'd go, well, being called the dictator of North Korea, that's kind of par for the course. But this person, makes clear that he professes to be a fellow believer and even a fellow Southern Baptist. And my guess is many of you have received similar kind of fan mail along the way. And it's one of those things of where I'm reminded at times, tragically, the enemy loves to use those who are fellow believers, other Christians, other churches, other institutions, to do his bidding. Oh, they may not always, send you a piece of fan mail, but it could be that drive-by tweet. Could be that cryptic tweet, subtweet, we're not exactly saying what we really think, but we're kind of throwing it out there to try to, throw shade over somebody else. Or we're going to find ways to continue to fight and to separate and to divide over non-essential matters. We're going to continue to find ways to fight. Look, if you've got a nature where you're always trying to find a fight, guess what? You're always going to find one. It will. It will. You will always have something that you can find to fight about. And one of the great travesties within our tribe is we've become really, really good at fighting and really, really good at warfare and really, really good at tearing down, but we have not figured out a way to actually win the peace. and to do that which is constructive rather than destructive. And at times, it can be frankly very discouraging doing ministry in an environment where you've got folks out there who are always looking to send sniper fire your way. That's why I'm drawn to this passage in Jeremiah. Because we get something from Jeremiah that is remarkably raw. It's remarkably authentic. It's remarkably real. Jeremiah has been proclaiming the Lord's message, finding unreceptivity, finding criticism, finding rejection from those who claim to be the Lord's own people, those who are attracted more to false prophets in their midst than to the man of God who is preaching the truth. And we get this expression of honesty where he's calling for vengeance against my persecutors. It wasn't just the persecutors in the pagan population. It was the persecutors even within what was claimed to be the household of faith within the nation. Know that I suffer disgrace for your honor. I bear your name. And he makes clear, I didn't sit in with a band of revelers. I didn't celebrate with them. Because your hand was on me, I sat alone. Realize one of the greatest realities of ministry is if you are going to follow the Lord in total obedience, total surrender, and with total integrity, it will mean at times you will stand alone. You will sit alone. There will always be those who will say, I'm right behind you, brother. And then you turn around and they're way behind you. So far behind you, you can't even see them. People can talk a good game when it's easy, when there's no cost to be paid, to do what's right, to say things that need to be said, to call out things that are things we oftentimes want to hide or to conceal rather than to reveal. And we get this incredible expression here in verse 18, why has my pain become unending and my wound incurable, refusing to be healed, even to the point of where he says, you truly have become like a mirage to me. Water that is not reliable. God, where are you? God, where are you when it hurts? Where are you when it hurts when I'm doing your work? Where are you when it hurts when I'm preaching your word? Where are you when it hurts when I'm here and the people who I thought should be receiving and embracing me are rejecting me and ridiculing me? Where are you, God? One of the greatest encouragements that we find when we read the pages of Scripture is we find those who've gone before us who have walked a path we will walk inevitably, who have suffered in ways that we can't fully appreciate or imagine. You know, you don't know what another brother or another sister is going through, really. Because every time we see one another, how are you doing? Fine. Great. Everything's okay. Do we ever go up to somebody and they say, how you doing? Worse? No, because we kind of have this veneer. We kind of have this exterior, this impression. We've got to keep up this image we've got to maintain. And what I appreciate so much about Jeremiah is he is so raw and authentic before God of saying, I'm hurting. And much of my hurt actually is coming from doing your work, from following your plan. What happened to my best life now? What happened to everything is going to be great and easy? We weren't promised that. In fact, God was remarkably kind to Jeremiah, letting him know, hey, this is the mission I've given to you, and your requirement is faithfulness, even when there is going to be rejection, ridicule, opposition. Still doesn't mean it doesn't hurt. None of us set out to not be liked in life. None of us set out to find ways to encourage people to not be our friends, hopefully, unless you're really unique in personality type. There is going to be pain and suffering when you are fully surrendered to God's plan for your life. There just is. And it's not just going to be from those who are opposed to God's agenda in terms of the broader culture, there's going to be pain and suffering even from within those who name the name of Christ and call themselves members of the household of faith. You know, that is a word and that is a warning. And the warning is we have to always be on guard for ourselves, for our churches, for our ministries, for our institutions, that we do not succumb to becoming a person or an institution that becomes a tool in the hands of the enemy that is used to literally bring about hurt and pain in the lives of others. Why is it that so many professing Christian churches and professing Christian entities and institutions too often, as they are in the midst of attempting to fulfill their mission, end up destroying the spirits and the souls of those who work within them? The testimonies of those who oftentimes have worked in supposedly Christian ministries, Christian environments, Christian institutions is devastating. It's as if we find at times more guidance for how to treat fellow believers from Sun Tzu's Art of War than we do from the pages of Holy Scripture. And nothing can be more anathema to the Spirit of Christ. If anything, our institutions, our ministries, our churches must model ways that we are able to be builders of the soul, not destroyers of the soul. Places where there is real hope and healing for the hurts. There's going to be pain and suffering when you follow God in the ministry, oftentimes from within. I grieve at so much of what I see happening in our Southern Baptist Convention today, where equally devoted, Bible-believing, conservative brothers and sisters continue to want to find ways not just to disagree, but to seemingly destroy one another. The people will say things on social media they would never have the courage to say to somebody else's face. And I'll just lovingly encourage you, if you wouldn't be able to look somebody else in the eye and say that to them, don't even think about tweeting it, or putting it on Facebook, putting it on Instagram, because it does not bear the credibility of Christ. And at times when you're tempted to criticize another brother or sister who may not agree on every finer point, every non-essential matter, find something to praise about that brother or sister first before you express that point of divergence or disagreement. Because remember, that person not only is a fellow image bearer, that person is somebody with whom we are together in a mission that is far more urgent, far more critical, far more needed today, given everything we see happening around us. We simply don't have time to devour ourselves when there is a watching world that desperately needs the hope of the gospel of Jesus Christ, who is looking to see, is there anybody out there who really cares, where we can genuinely find a people who are committed to the kind of New Testament Christianity, to the kind of Jesus-centered approach that I keep reading about if I open the Bible, but I just don't see enough of it actually being lived out, even from those who claim to be Christ's followers. Therefore, this is what the Lord says, verse 19. If you will return, I will take you back. You will stand in my presence. And if you speak noble words rather than worthless ones, you will be my spokesman. It is they who must return to you. You must not return to them. Then I will make you a fortified wall of bronze to this people. They will fight against you, but will not overcome you. For I am with you. Is there any greater promise than that? Is there any greater affirmation than that? Is there any greater encouragement than that? Even in the midst of his pain, God's presence is just as real, just as certain. It may not always be able to be felt in the hurt, but it doesn't mean God is any less there or any less cares. Right in the midst of the pain and suffering is his presence. And not just is his presence, but is the promise of victory, right? I am with you to save you and rescue you. This is the Lord's declaration. I will rescue you from the power of evil people and redeem you from the grasp of the ruthless. See, the call when people want to fight dirty is not to fight dirtier. The call when people want to go low is not to go lower. The call is to stay faithful. To realize it's the Lord who fights the battles. It's the Lord who takes vengeance. It's the Lord who will settle all the scores. My responsibility is not to try to get even or even to get right, but it is to be right in my walk, my ministry, my commitment, my role. That's what matters most. At the end of the day, there are going to be all kinds of voices out there trying to tell you what kind of ministry you should have, how you should choose to engage, how you should choose to do what you do. There can be those who will be seeking to promise you all kinds of earthly powers and prestige and promise if you'll just kind of follow their agenda, their will, their plan, their way. But oftentimes they'll even encourage you. It's okay to step on somebody else as you're climbing to the top. It's okay to use people to further your agenda. That's okay, because we can always baptize that in a veneer of spirituality that can sound so alluring, but is so ultimately satanic in nature. Always ask yourself the question, whose voice am I listening to? Is it the crowd? Is it the alluring voice of the evil one? Or is it the voice of the one who fights our battles, who judges our hearts, who does what is right, even when it hurts, who sent his only begotten Son, Jesus the Christ, to die as a sacrifice and an atonement for sinners, a death that hurt, a death of excruciating pain, not just the physical torment, but the weight of bearing the sin of the world, our sin, your sin, my sin, on him. And in every moment where he had the chance to fight back, he was fully surrendered to the Father's plan, knowing that the Lord was with him and that he was the Lord. Particularly between now and over the next few months, as we're in a very interesting time in the Southern Baptist Convention, my prayer is that God will use you, the men and women who make up the community of faith called the Southwestern Baptist Theological Seminary and Scarborough College, to be instruments of hope and healing, of unity, rather than those who are stirrers up of strife, sowers of discord, division, dissension, those who ultimately become tools in the hands of the enemy, not in the hands of our Lord. Are we perfect? No. We'll fail, but we continue to press on, to strive, to be found faithful. Particularly in a moment where I believe our convention of churches desperately needs men and women who will model. We stand firmly upon the truths we confess, the Baptist faith and message, the high view of Scripture. We're committed to our Great Commission work together, to cooperation, realizing we can't do it alone. But we do these things drawn out of a heartbeat of gratitude for the fact that of all the people in the universe that God could have chosen to live out your calling, He chose you. He chose you. Not because of you, but that His glory and His grace and His gospel might be made known in and through you. And so as we begin a new semester together here at Southwestern Seminary and Scarborough College, let us recommit ourselves together to coming together. In fact, the Latin word from which we derive our English term convocation literally means a coming together. If there's ever a time for the Southwestern Seminary family, for the Southern Baptist Convention to come together, it is now. May the Lord find us faithful and make us fruitful for His kingdom service, even when it hurts. May we remember there is always His hope.